Good afternoon. Welcome to Eruset Network. Friend, as you know, this week we have a discussion on sociology. We have different topics for discussion, but we'll today start with the contemporary sociology. We'll try to understand what does it mean, what are the major themes of a study. And you know, the contemporary society also explained through, as said that this is a modern society, a modern society is characterized by information age. So how the information technology has changed the characteristics of the society, major part of that we will try to understand. And one of the characteristic is the surveillance. Either you are working in the company, MNC, multinational companies, you are outside, right? So you are under surveillance, it is said, through mobile or something, other devices. So how this has given a new kind of space to for the sociological study, we'll try to understand. And for discussion on this very topic, we have in the studio Dr. Manoj Kumar Jena. He is presently assistant professor of sociology in Jamia Millia Islamia University, and he has written 2 textbooks and contributed many articles in peer-reviewed journals. So I think his knowledge and experience will certainly help us to understand this topic. So on your behalf, I welcome him for the lecture on the topic contemporary sociological thinking. Welcome.
Thank you very much, Amarendraji, for your kind word. It's indeed a pleasure for me to be here to deliver a lecture on contemporary sociology in general, and particularly surveillance in society in particular. As you know that, you know, it's a phase of phenomenal transformation is occurring in terms of technology, in terms of culture, in terms of our social life. And within that domain, we are trying to understand what kind of transformation occurring in terms of our sociological studies. If you see the present contemporary sociology as such nowadays, it's now we are focusing on something on what you called technology, culture, and mediation, so and so forth. And primarily here, if you see, the idea is that it's all about computer, it's all about memory, computation, control, it's all about, you know, information productive power. And this is the phase, and this is the age of information technology and knowledge, and where we are utilizing information, we are generating information, and information is the base for our economic activities, of our political activities, and as well as of our social activities. And again, you can see it's a emergence of the different voluntary communities, and it's all about the future shock, terror, invasion of privacy, and as well as the electronic surveillance. Nowadays, if you see the many sociologists, in fact, starting from Manuel Castells, you know, Alvin Toffler, and David Leon, in all of them, they have contributed immensely towards the growth and development of this contemporary sociological studies. Today, in fact, we are going to focus on particularly one of the important aspects of, you know, contemporary sociology, that is surveillance studies. Let's talk about and try to understand the surveillance as such. As you know that it's a surveillance something, you know, it's a scrutiny through the use of technical means to extract or create personal or group data, whether from the individual or context. For example, if you see the computer matching, profiling, and data mining, work computer and electronic location monitoring, DNA analysis, drug tests, brain scan, and all these things are combined together, and we are collecting lots of data, and we are also utilizing the data either for developmental purposes or from repressing activities. It has been, we have a specific designed software for that. And now the question is arising over here that are you moving towards a society or a suspicious society or a society where absolutely scrutinized and controlled and regulated human behavior and in everywhere, in all ways, we are absolutely under the surveillance. So, on the basis of that, you know, one can see this is the society where, you know, we are controlled, regulated and monitored by the different kind of, you know, technological machines and what you call the closed circuit cameras, CCTV. And when we are trying to understand the surveillance society, it has a long history of surveillance society. Today, you know, if you are trying to understand the today's situation and today's context, you have to understand the development of this surveillance society as such. If you see the modern government, you know, for example, the modern society, when I started, that the registration of the birth, marriage and death, it was an important aspect of surveillance activities. And we can see the surveillance is strongly bound up with our compliance with the current social order. It can be means of social control. How to control the citizen is, it's an important thing. And particularly, when I'm talking about surveillance study, James Rule in 1973, he considered that the surveillance as an, you know, embedded aspects of relations between state and population. And surveillance entails a means of knowing when rules are being obeyed, when they are broken, and most importantly, who is responsible for which. And while Rule focuses on the social order and possible punishment, that was the important, you know, study by the James Rules. And if you see the surveillance technology, then the nowadays introduction of the new surveillance technologies, and it has a very interesting social impact, and as well as the impacting our social life, like people like David Leon, you know, 2001. In his interesting, you know, book, Electronic Eye and Surveillance Society, he's talking about that the information collection and analysis involved in surveillance, suggesting a definition of surveillance as any collection and processing of personal data, whether identifiable or not, for the purpose of influencing or managing them whose data have been generated. Now, David Lyon is one of the important, you know, contemporary sociologists. He has contributed immensely for the surveillance studies. And as well as when I'm talking about David Lyon, when I'm talking about, you know, surveillance society, we have to focus on Michel Foucault. Michel Foucault's work on discipline and punish, what is the rise of prison in 1977, he has talked about panopticon, and basically he was influenced by the Jeremy Bentham's idea of the panopticon, and he has utilize, he has what he called, he has studied very intrinsically the relationship between technology, knowledge and power. You know, for him, the what he called the panopticon is a kind of power mechanism. So now we can discuss about the surveillance studies in contemporary social order. If you see the within after 1970s and 80s, in extensively there is a growth and expansion of surveillance studies. Two decades, many people they are associated to study the surveillance mechanism, and due to introduction of the new technology. While surveillance practice are, as you know, that as old as human history, they took some rather specific forms in the modern world, becoming routinely and systematic based especially on individuation and bureaucratic organization. So, as you know that the surveillance studies, as I have already talked about, it's not a new phenomena, you know, it's a age old phenomena, it has a historical context also. You know, I think in the 15th century that the religious surveillance was a powerful and dominant form, and routinely policing of the religious consciousness, rituals, and what you call the religious organization. They are very much specifically, concerned about the practice of a particular rituals and maintaining religious order. That is an important phase in the 15th century Europe as well as some part of India. And if you see the 16th century, with the appearance of the growth of embryonic nation state, when the development of the nation state was occurred, which had both the new needs and developing capacity to greater end use of information, political surveillance become increasingly important, religious surveillance. And if you see the nation state when emerging, now the state is collecting lots of information for their citizens. From the last part of the 20th century onward, it has become clear that the new technology would be implicated decisively in the surveillance processes, as computer-based system are much more and very important for us. Now it's collection of the data and computation and generation of the data and regulation, now it's very important in this social order. And if specifically, if you see the modern society, surveillance has occupied a very important and distinct place in our sociological studies. George Orwell's 1984 novel, it was a very interesting novel, it's a best-selling novel where he's talking about the idea of Big Brother. And this ideas, utilized and what you called interpreted by many sociologists. And James Rule's, as I have already talked about, James Rule's study, the private lives and public surveillance has appeared in the early 1770. It was another text which has established the strong hold of surveillance study within sociology. Then we have to also analyze Michel Foucault's celebrated and continuous historical studies of surveillance and discipline had appeared that mainstream social theorists began to take surveillance seriously in its own right. I think many people in contemporary sociologist, in contemporary society, they are also influenced by the Foucault's work. The prominent work carried out after Foucault also, and before Foucault also, we had a tradition starting from the Maxian and Weberian, though they have not contributed directly to the surveillance study, but you can through Marx's work and the Weberian's work, we can also interpret the surveillance study. If you see, Karl Marx is talking about the capitalistic mode of production, when he's talking about capitalism, he's also focusing something on the managerial control and controlling the capital. And Karl Marx focuses our special attention on the surveillance as an aspect of the struggle between labor and capital. And overseeing the monitoring works is viewed here as a means of maintaining managerial control on behalf of the capital and the modern disciplines of the capital surveillance. So this is an important aspect of Marxian idea. Simultaneously, Max Weber concentrated on the way that all modern organizations develop means of storing and retrieving data in forms of files as part of the quest of efficient practice within bureaucracy, because he was focusing on the bureaucracy and that he was talking about the efficient practices within the bureaucracy. Such files frequently contain personal information so that the organization, especially governmental administrators, can keep tab on population. That's the one contribution of the Max Weber. And again, when I'm talking about other people like the Zimmel, he was talking about urban metropolis and keeping eye on the urban metropolis, on the population. And when in Durkheim, disciplinary responses to grow social inequality, he was trying to study that. We can say it's all these are the panopticon, studies, pre-panopticon studies, what you call the scopic regimes of modernity. And now I'll will focus specifically on Michel Foucault's work and as well as the surveillance study. Michel Foucault, he was the important figure in contemporary sociology, and he has contributed immensely in terms of the history of sexuality, in terms of the discipline and punish, in terms of, you know, genealogy of power. He has extensively talked about various aspects of power relationship within society. So his book Discipline and Punish was the central to the new debates, even though surveillance appeared as theme in several of Foucault's work. You know, many ways, if you see the Foucault has already talked about surveillance mechanism in many of his work. Genealogy of power, the genealogy of power is concerned, for his genealogy of power is concerned with the relationship between knowledge and power within the human sciences, and their practice concerned with the regulation of bodies, the government of conduct, and the formation of self. This is a very interesting connection what he has argued. That is all about the regulation of the bodies when he is talking about birth of clinic, when he is talking about modern medicine, and as well as the government conduct and the formation of self. And in his work of this Discipline and Punish, the Birth of Prison, he has extensively discussed that knowledge give birth to technologies that exert power. It's talking about the power relationship. In this context, he deals with the panopticon. He has borrowed this idea from Bentham, and he's applying the idea of the panopticon to study the power relationship. What we are popularly known as the relationship between technology, what you call the technology, knowledge and power. For him, panopticon is a structure that gives, you know, official the possibility of the complete observation of criminals. The panopticon is a tremendous source of power for prison officials because it gives them the possibility of total surveillance. You know, the one can say it's absolutely and controlled and regulated. Somebody is controlling, somebody is regulating, sitting somewhere corner of a room, and which is invisible to the prisoner, the prison people. So it is a clear linkage between the knowledge, technology and power, what Foucault has argues. For Foucault, the panopticon is a kind of laboratory for the gathering information about the people. You know, it's a kind of laboratory where you are gathering, you know, information about the people. And Foucault, extending the idea of the Bentham's panopticon to analyzing the whole power structure within the society. And again, it's not only the Foucault. Many people, they are also influenced by Michel Foucault's work. And they are also influenced people like Webster, Frank Webster and Robbins. They are talking about electronic technology dependent surveillance, which is very important for us to contextualize and analyze in the contemporary sociology. And also David Leon, they have also talked about that as well. And we have to understand the sovereign power in one hand, and as well as the, controlling, regulating the individual, documenting about them, and some kind of repressive them as well. For example, Poster, you know, he was is a very important contemporary sociologist. He has contributed immensely for, you know, what he called information society studies. The work of Foucault is considered what he called the influence, influenced by Poster, is influenced by Foucault's work. He termed the super panopticon. It's not about only the panopticon, it's much more than that. It's all about the super panopticon. And through that, he is also trying to analyze that. Then the idea subsequently by the Norris and Armstrong, their analysis of the United, they have a very interesting studies they have conducted in America, where they have done a study on the CCTV camera. You know, for example, the state-driven mass categorization and information management mechanism, which act on the action of the population, that through the which way nowadays the government, the state is controlling and collecting and managing information about the citizens and about the population. And now in the surveillance discourse, we are trying to analyze the whole idea of the surveillance studies within the modern society as well as the postmodern and post-industrial society. As you know that we are in a phase of information society where the information utility and collection of information is very important. And then within that, the surveillance mechanism is very important, where you are absolutely monitoring and using data on socioeconomic class, gender and ethnicity, which today must be applied area of the literal CCTV as well as the literal data mining watching, not to mention watch lists. So watching is maybe a metaphorical nowadays, the work timing machine of the factory, the office file and the city plan as well as the physical and what you call the watch over others. This is a very important thing. It's a collection of data through the biometric data and collection of lots of information about socioeconomic class, about the gender, caste, so and so forth. Now, after being said that, the question within surveillance studies, the two important questions for us: how surveillance power is dangerously concentrated on one agency or institution, number one. The number two, how repressive forms of surveillance may relate to the broader circumstances such as polarization, social and economic inequalities. So these are the very important and pertinent questions within the surveillance study. Let's talk about different theoretical viewpoints. People like the cultural theories, they have focused on the discursive indulging digital means on simulation and on speed, that where they are talking about digitalization of culture and digitalization digital expansion of a digital culture, and through that some kind of surveillance activities are occurring. And even if the theories of media and technology are vital to this enterprise also, because the new technology assume powers of their own, how far they are fused with the human and how far they contribute to the structuring of the social relations, that's our also very important concern for us. And again, we have to also understand the logic of technology. When you're talking about technology, culture and mediation and all sort of development of the communication technology, we have to also understand the logic of technology, because the ongoing negotiation between the social entities, cultural, economic, political and social technological system. Now it's all about the technocentric society, even where it's a technological system, and where we are every other day we are negotiating with that, and we are absolutely connected with that kind of paradigm. Although many analysts, technological commentator, they have also talked about that, and they are also focusing on the fast moving, fragmented, disembedded aspects of the contemporary culture. It is worth nothing that those affected by the mobile technology as such, and the mobile sociology as such. John Wirey is talking about mobile sociology, it is a mobile life. Zygmunt Bauman is also talking about the liquid life as such. It is all about, it's a moving around within that technological paradigm, within the within that information paradigm. And then when you're talking about the mobile technology and surveillance nowadays, the mobile, simple mobile, is a very important technological artifacts for us. Now every other day we are always talking about mobile, and we are absolutely, one can say, emotionally also attached with the mobile phone. This is the most important artifact for us nowadays. And if you see when I'm talking about mobile phone, now it's what the John Wirey is talking about, inhabited machine. you know, for him, when he's trying to analyze the whole development, the growth of the mobile technology, different technological aspects, when he's talking about fluidity of life, and he's analyzing, and for him, the 21st century or the contemporary century, two artifacts are very important. One is the inhabited machines, and as well as the inhabited, when he's talking about inhabited machine, he's talking about the cars and the mobile phones. For him, these machines is to be connected with the site across the world, which is an important aspect of globalization, helping to make the world feel like one place. What Vray observes but does not elaborate is that simultaneously such sites can monitor, observe and trace each inhabited machine. So it's that's the aspect, you know, that through that machine, through that inhabited machine, particularly, you know, mobile phone, someone can monitor us, you know, someone can, you know, observe us, someone can trace our location. David Lyon, you know, when he's talking about that, it is such monitoring, observing and tracing that is important in a present day society, because he has the, as I have already pointed out, he is the important contributor in the study of surveillance society. And he argues the why you are matters increasingly from the point of view of the contemporary regime of governance, because, you know, the also, you know, the governance, in terms of the governance, now the state is also watching you, what he called the big brother, the state. And the mobile phone is also, you know, enabled with the GPS technology, and through that one can monitor, one can observe, one can trace their usages, continuously in the real time. Someone can locate you. So, and surveillance capacities are enhanced in various systems within the mobile phones as well, and you have a smartphone also. If we can see the number of technologies, new kind of technologies attached with the smartphone. Through that smartphone, through that mobile phone, one can, you know, one can monitor you, one can watch you. What he is arguing, you know. For example, like the rules, and when he's talking about there's a connection in between the what he called the power relationship in between the citizens in one end as well as the state, and through a particular, you know, technological machines or technological artifacts. And although mobile may have has some kind of positive consequences for democratic processes, many people, they are also talking about that through the new kind of technology, it's a kind of deepening of democracy, but many people, they are also simultaneously criticizing, it's not a deepening of democracy, it's also dividing. But you know, one can also analyzing, it's a kind of power relationship, you know, within that, with a particular technology in one hand, those who are using, and as well as the state. And surveillance in mobile technology may be connected with the power relationships, it can be better or worse. That's the kind of, you know, argument given by the David, you know, Lyon. As mobility is monitored more and more, it is easy to be distract the privacy debate. Now, that's another debate within the surveillance study, is that the privacy, it's all about, in it's a society where the privacy is very important. And he argues, David Lyon argues that the the question about the privacy in one side, at the outset, some of the issues surrounding mobile telephony have to be do with the overheading conversation and in the sense of privacy. This is the another important issue. Now, when I'm talking about introduction of the new kind of technology, when I'm talking about monitoring, regulation, the privacy is also very important issue that needs to be addressed. And that's the relationship between the public places as well as the mass transit system, and our involvement with the technology and utilization of the technology, so and so forth. And then specifically on the issue of governance, within that electronic technology, the surveillance is generalized across population for numerous overlapping purposes, and virtual as a liquid spaces. what you called, you know, now the governance, for example, when you're talking about the governance, we are talking about modes of governing populations, whether or not the nation state is involved, social order, and the state has to achieve certain kind of social order is achieved and maintained through a kind of what you call the surveillance mechanism or a new surveillance mechanism. And for example, what you call the mobile nomadic form of control that utilize coded information to monitor, predict and direct the behavior of individuals, what the David Lyon is talking about. So now it's a live nomadic form of control that utilize coded information. Coded information in the sense is that you are collecting, you know, all sort of micro information about a citizens through either through the biometric, either through the genetic mapping, either through any kind of, you know, race and data analysis. So you are collecting lots of information in what you call the coded information about a citizen, and you are trying to monitor that, predict and direct the behavior of the individual. That's a new, you know, development through different kind of technological means. And again, the mobile commerce also is that the becoming dominant site of mobile surveillance. Now, it's when you're talking about mobile commerce, you know, it's something about the now the different, you know, companies. They are utilizing your information. They are, you know, maybe they are utilizing, maybe they are misutilizing. They are selling your information. You know, many a times we are also getting different calls from the different company. Even you don't know about them. This is all about the manipulation, utilization, coded information sold by some of the agencies. So that means, one can say the mobile phone is a time, space and surveillance mechanism. It's a connection in between the time, space and the surveillance mechanism. Now let's talk about the technology and surveillance, in particular what the, David Lyon is talking about. The electronic surveillance has to do with the ways that computer databases are used to store, process and personal information on different kinds of population. Now, as we have talked about, it's all about technological society. Its technology is very important for us. Whether for developmental purposes we are talking about, you are relying upon the technology, we are saying that through technological development, through innovations, we can develop a particular country, we can provide a quality of life. Always, and we are trying to emphasize on technological development. So through that technology also, so the electronic surveillance is also occurring. That in a sense is that what you call the personal information on different kinds of population, examining the surveillance society may be seen as a case study of interaction between technology and society. It's all about, if you see the through the surveillance mechanism, it's a kind of, you know, interaction in between the technology and society. It's a, you can see it's a very intrinsic relationship and of technological determinants with the society at large. Simultaneously, Alvin Toffler in his work The Third Wave and Future Shock, he has already talked about the technological driven society, both extremely, you know, when he's talking about the technological determinants, which is the important factor for our developmental activities, for our, you know, manipulating or controlling population, or you are talking about you know, expansion and growth of the business activities, what the Manuel Castells has talked about, new enterprises, you know, what he called the network society, through that technology is the main base, where he is talking about information communication technology is the most important determinant, where we are talking about network society, we are talking about, you know, connection in between the individual in one hand, culture as well as the society at large. So then the question is arise over here, what are the important issues within the surveillance within the whole, you know, information society paradigm, or within that the whole idea of the information age. So you see, the new communication and information technologies, particularly in the information age, permit a massive extension and transformation of what you call the mobilization of different kind of information, utilization of different kind of information, manipulation of the different kind of information for different purposes. This is a very important thing which is happening in the information age. Now, every other day we are, you know, collecting lots and lots of information about everybody. You know, all our conversation which has been recorded, you know, processed and maybe sold, maybe manipulated. These are the very important happening is occurring within that or in this information age. And when you're trying to understand the information revolution, when you're talking about diffusion of the information technology or utilization of technology, we have to also understand the hierarchic relationship. You know, some people, they are information haves and some are information have nots. Some people, they are, you know, controlled by that information and some are controlling the information. And the teeny minority, some people, they are controlling the larger group in this society through that technology. So therefore, you know, David Lyon is arguing that electronic surveillance both specifically shaped as a social impact as well as, you know, predictability. You know, it has a very intrinsic social impact. We have to understand that as well. And he is also talking about the computer matching is a technique used for the government department of the late 1970s and it was widespread by the early 90s. So, here he is trying to focus on that the expansion of the different technologies in a particular phase. If you take an example of the Manuel Castells is talking about, when he is talking about rise of information society, he is focusing on 1970 was the important departure phase where the expansion of technological expansion is occurring and the ICT revolution of ICT is occurring. It's a widespread of utilization of information, utilization of communication technology. Now, David Lyon is also, you know, arguing in the same manner. He is talking about that the government department, they are also utilizing that same, you know, technology, what is the computer matching technology or information technology to understand, to regulate the human behavior, create a kind of social control. They are putting CCTV camera everywhere and they are trying to regulate the the citizens through that particular technology and creating a terror inside our mind, he is arguing. So, the same study conducted by Jerry T. Marks, study that he called the new surveillance, is specifically arguing that the police organization and in particularly United States of America is using computer technology for regulating the human behavior. And they are also using computer matching technologies and particularly the new technology to understand different kind of, you know, matching. What you call the matching in the sense is that they are trying to analyze that that he is the same person to whom they are trying to trap, and they are trying to collect the information and they are utilizing the information, they are spreading the information to across different states. So therefore, Gary argues that the power of computer system to relate data from various sources and gathered with the different purposes has inspired numerous experiments with personal information. The two or more unrelated computerized file of individual are matched to identify the group of people in a similar category. So that's a very important for the lawmaker, you know, because in this particular era, that's one hand we have a surveillance mechanism, we have a legal law, lawmakers as well as the state, and they are, working together, because as you know that this is the phase of convergence technology, and they are utilizing different kind of convergence technology to understand and regulate and study the human behavior as well as control the human being. And again, David's book, you know, what he called the Rise of the Computer State, he is also talking about new computer technology is argument themselves beyond the direct control of the anyone at alone elect the decision makers. Nowadays, it's a computer as the main, you know, player. When he's talking about what you call the computer state, when he's talking about, it's not about the individual, they are governing the state, but through that technology, they are the governing state. And what the Daniel Bale is talking about, technocrats, they are much more important. Then he's also talking about the autonomous technology positions. He's talking about the whole idea of the, what he sees that the new technology almost, you know, as a tool of capitalism or of repressive states. It's all about repressive state. It's all about control and regulated by the state mechanism. Anthony Giddens is also an important figure in our contemporary studies. He has extensively contributed on, you know, modernity, you know, high risk society, and with you know, Willerick Beck and Beck, they have also contributed on high risk society. Anthony Giddens is talking about the surveillance. For him, the surveillance is a gathering of data and supervising the people, but this may be less salient as a form of supervision by the various agencies. And he's also talking about technology, debate of technology society relationship, and he's also focusing on the electronic surveillance in a sense is that through that the state is also collecting some kind of information. Through that they are also trying to regulate. And if you see the whole idea of the computer system within our, you know, contemporary sociology, now the computer is also associated with the communication system. Now, you know, mediate all kinds of relationship, you know, to participate in the modern society or in a modern society under the electronic surveillance. For example, take an example. If you want to understand the our present day, you know, society now, most of us, we are part of the network, social networking sites. We are using Facebook. We are using, you know, Orkut. Now Orkut is out of date. Now it's outdated from the technological and from the what you called network you know, social networking sites. You know, Twitter. These are the parts. And through that, you know, you can see. This is a kind of when you are utilizing or when you are using a particular website or social networking sites, you are also monitored. You know, you are also, you know, somebody is watching you. We don't know, because maybe some organizations and private organization, they are watching us. They are also trying to understand what are the sites we are visiting, with whom you are interacting. These are the very important, you know, things are happening in the phase of convergence, in the phase of information age. And as well as, for instance, if you take an example of the bank machine and making a phone call, applying for a driving license, using of a credit card, receiving a junk mail, picking up books from a library, and crossing a border on a trip to abroad. These are the all this, you know, through that also, you know, lots of data, you know, generated, you know, people, they are generating lots of data, and they, through that they are also trying to understand, you know, the behavioral aspects of the individual. And if you see after, you know, talking about this we can see in the concluding part. Now the individuals becomes the object of surveillance, you know, nowadays. You know, all of us, whether you are talking from individual level, whether you are talking about the community, whether you are talking about the state or in the global phase, everywhere we are visualizing that we are object of surveillance and no longer subject of communication. So everywhere, though, when we are talking about a culture of mediation, but nevertheless, we are also object of surveillance. We can see that the technological system is being constituted to ensure the centralized and furtive inspections, observations, surveillance, and documentation of activities on the circumstances of society or circumstances of society as a whole. If you see, through the different, you know, sophisticated technological system, you know, we are observed, we are surveillanced, we are documented, many of our activities are being documented. And if you see the cable television network, for example, can continuously monitor consumer preferences for programming material along with detail of any financial or communicative transactions. If you see the, when you are watching certain kind of programs on television, through that we are also monitors that the company is trying to see that how many people they are watching this particular program, so that they will bargain with the companies, those who are giving them advertisement, look, these are the, we have a good number of viewers, so on the basis of that you will provide us some kind of, you know, revenue. So again, we have the we can also see the, you know, interlinked networks of bureaucratic and commercial data bank that accumulate and aggregate information on the activities, transactions, needs and desire for the individual or the social group. One can also see that's all about is it's a kind of infocracy. When you are moving from bureaucratic structure to the infocratic structure, it's also we are, you know, somewhere down the line, we are also controlled, regulated. There are lots of data, data banks available, and they are, the people, they are selling the data to the particular company, and through that they are also trying to control, they are trying to understand a company. And the new information and communication technologies extended this capacity is that observed and scrutinized individual subjected to continuous registration becomes the object of knowledge of files and records. This is interestingly, the, you know, David Lyon is also talking about in a same way. The again, the another point is that the ability to mobilize and control through watching and monitoring, and through that the power expresses itself as a surveillance and panopticonism, now on the scale of the society as a whole. Now one can say it's a society, it's through that panopticon machine somebody is watching us. And what you call the electronic grid is a, in the transparent structure in which activities are taking place at the peripheral, remote working, electronic banking and consumption of electronic entertainment and information, teleshopping, communication are visible to the electronic eye of centralized computer systems that manage the networks. This particular argument, this particular, you know, sentence is specifically talking about that, you know, whether it is a electronic banking, whether it is a consumption of entertainment or information, whether it is your shopping, whether you are communicating, everything, it's a visible to the electronic eye. Electronic, the centralized computer system that manage the networks, it's a electronic eye that's managing the system. And as well as the technical process of administration and numerous electronic transactions is simultaneously are integrated. The electronic worker, the consumer or the communicator is constantly scanned, and his or her needs, preferences and activities are driven off as information to the agencies and institutions at the heart of the networks. It's as I have already talked about, it's all about the network society. The society, its connection, it's well connected with each other through the information, and different institutions and different agencies are playing simultaneously together. So this was the basic idea about the surveillance studies, because it is now a surveillance study is a very important, you know, issue within the contemporary sociology, and we have tried and analyzed different aspects of the surveillance studies, through starting from the Foucauldian idea of panopticon to the David Lyon's electronic eye.
What are the characteristic of network society? The major characteristic.
Yeah, the basic, the whole idea of the, when I'm talking about the network society, you know, it's all about network enterprises. The basic primary base is that what you call the ICT, information communication technology, is one hand. Then as well as take example of the Manuel Castells. Manuel Castells is talking about the information or the network society is somehow it's connected with information communication technology one hand, as well as the informational economy. And the third important point for is network enterprises. and as well as the flow of fluidity. John Wiley, they are also talking extensively on that. It's all about the mobility, it's all about the fluidity, it's all about the movement of image, movement of the people from one place to other place. They are also arguing in the same manner that this network society in one way is supplying some sort of nourishment towards the expansion and growth of globalization.
Okay, the critic of Castles say that Castles has just explained the network society as on the basis of Marx has explained in the industrial and post-industrial society. So, what do you say? What is
For example, if you see Manuel Castells, he is also critical about the network society. What he is talking about the social polarization. You know, social, when he's arguing about the social polarization, extensively he's talking about that's a sharp, you know, division in between the information haves and information have-nots. You know, where he's arguing that the information is not even percolated down to the lower level. You know, if you see the Marxian notion, the Marx is also talking about capital. When you can also utilize the same argument, you can see the transnational capital, right. The flow of the transnational capital, you know, across the border. But the development and the growth and expansion of the transnational capital is not systematic at all. And it's you can see nowadays. We can analyze if we'll talk about the Pippa Norris, who is talking about digital divide. That's an absolute division in between the North and South, North world and South world. The predominantly America and Europe, somewhere they are controlling environment, as well as the all the third world countries. These are the what one can say disparity. Well, is the social polarization.
So as you said, that the only difference in the form. Castle talks about the information in the form of capitals. So, in practice we find that both wealth and information, those who are purging these two, they are succeeding in current contemporary society. So, right. How do you explain and what could be the alternative mode of explanation?
For example, if you see now, as you have rightly pointed out, you know, that the information is very important nowadays. The technological information, utilization of information, if you want to understand the whole, you know, idea of the information society, it's all about the mental labor, you know, the utilization of the information and production of the information. And Manuel Castells is focusing on that. His basic argument, if you see his rise of network society, when he's extensively talked about that, the Japan and the America, they are the important bigger player in this information age, and because these people, they are part of this information society. But now when you're talking about the alternative model, if you see, this is a this is all about the technological world. Anyhow, you have to focus on your innovative aspects. I'll give you an example of our recent technological policy statement. 2013, recently the government of Ministry of Science and Technology, they have come out with that. Extensively, they are talking about innovation and innovative technology. And sustainable innovation is very important. And where we are also focusing on our, you know, local knowledge and local technologies. How to utilize that through information, this is also a very important aspect. But now, for critics, those who are arguing, don't try to borrow the European model. Don't try to borrow the American model. You can also utilize, and if you are borrowing that model, you have to understand your context. Is this model is suitable for you, or you will develop another model? So this is another question within that, you know, information paradigm. And because this is also problematic, because many people, they have talked about that, Lack Scott, you know, Scott is also critiquing about that information society.
So how the methodology of a study has change got shift in this?
Yeah, that's a very interesting question within the sociology. Right. Now see, that's a shift from the traditional community to the virtual community. Now if you see, it's all about the cyberspace. It's all about the cybernetic state. It's all about new phase of governance. You look at the whole way of surveillance. The shift has occurred. One can see the sociology in the information age. Now you are also studying the image, what Bauman is talking about, liquid life. it's a new way of modernity is occurring. It's all about the risk. We don't know what will happen tomorrow. It's all about the future shock. That in that way, that's a shift from the shift is occurring. What one can say, some paradigm shift is occurring in terms of the methodology, in terms of technique, in terms of study of our life, because this culture is it's a shift of a new kind of culture, new kind of mediation of different kind of relationships.
So cybernetics is now a reliable model of studying the thing.
Absolutely, because that's another question. Reliability, and if you are going to reliable on that or not, that's another question, because that's a lots of debate is going on cybernetic state, starting from the Habermas to the John Cannon. They are talking about that. But this is a new thing is occurring. It's a new happening within the contemporary sociology. If you are primarily going to focus on the contemporary sociology, these are the new things happening within our discipline. Whether you can say it's a sub-discipline, but now we are moved beyond from that kind of theory. We are talking about interdisciplinarity. So therefore, as I have already talked about technology, knowledge, culture, power, mediation, now that the part of this, you know, new discourse, what we call the information discourse.
Means any sociological event need to be analyzed from this perspective.
For example, take an example of if you are talking about gender relationship nowadays, if you are talking about labor issues nowadays, if you are talking about, you know, mediation, communication, you have to analyze, you have to, you know, contextualize within this framework, what you call the post-industrial, post-modern, whatever, you know, terminology you will use, post-modern, post-industrial or information domain, that you have to contextualize within that domain, that discourse.
So, as you said, that post-modernism and post, does it exist in reality? It is just a kind of analytical point of view, you can say.
When you are talking about the idea of the modernity and post-modernity, it's a basically, take example of many sociologists, they are talking about that.
Because few of them just suggest that those who are mixing with traditional and modernistic perspective, they are the post-modernism.
This is a very debate about that, you know, many people, they are also criticizing. Lautrec is an important figure. When, if you see his work on post-modern conditions, he is trying to analyze through architecture, through the music, through the, you know, literature, through cinema. That's a kind of post-modern. When they're talking, it's a movement from modernistic approach to the new phase. When I'm trying to analyze the modernist, essentially we are trying to understand from the European model. We are moving beyond from that. Foucault, you know, and Jean Baudrillard, they are talking about, it's a hyper reality. It's a Derrida, yes, they have talked about deconstruction language. This is a new kind of movement. And in terms of, you see, in terms of the information society, we are also talking about the post-industrial society. We have moved beyond from the industrial society to the post-industrial society. In a sense, is that now in terms of the labor, in terms of your workplace, in terms of your technology, in terms of your work activities, it's just some kind of shift is occurring. Through that, you can also visualize.
Okay, yeah. And that shift is to a stay. That will give another.
So shift. This is the society. It's a continuous changing process. And as a sociologist, we are trying to understand that. And some of these European sociologists, they are predicting that, they are anticipating that. You know, this is a, you know, unending process. It's a continuous flow. It's a fluidity. It's a flow. It will happen.
Okay. Yeah. So, societies also need to be taken into account within a boundary and analyzed accordingly. Like in Indian society is to be analyzed through the Indian perspective and all that. The methodology and the methods which is being adopted in the Western society and here. So, new kind of thing, how has emerged? Can you throw light on that?
Primarily, if you see, we have a different kind of, you know, studies. You know, European, they have studied our society. The Indian, they have studied our society. You must have, you know, the Indological perspective. The Indians, they have studied the Indian society. Earlier, we had a Eurocentric view. Mm-hmm. And we have Indians, many Indians, they are also studying the Indian society. But now many sociologists in India, in fact, they are also studying this contemporary social life very minutely. In fact, nowadays, whatever you know methodologies we have, whatever idea, knowledge, epistemological issues we have, it's all about the global. Now, okay. We don't have a specific boundary nowadays, and we don't have any specific boundary. We don't have any encompassed circle, but we have moved beyond to that. This is the one thing, new thing is happening within our society. And second important point is that now we are also contributing immensely, you know, in terms of many Indians, they have studied American society,
right.
American culture, the European culture as such. We are also contributing immensely. That's an interesting development which is happening in the contemporary society,
so
in the contemporary sociological literature. Okay. Yeah.
So, well, friends, with this word, we conclude the lecture. I thank all of you for watching the lecture. And on your behalf, I thank Dr. Manoj Kumar Jaina for giving such an insightful lecture on this very topic. Thank you very much.